The Craftsman Truck Series rolls into the City of Blues, Memphis, Tennessee. Ted Musgrave rocked this track a year ago and was the headliner in Victory Lane. But today's lineup is filled with talented players looking to take center stage. Guys like Sprague, Quaffle, and Setzer top a list of stars that know how to find the main stage at Memphis Motorsports Park. Memphis, Tennessee, we've got a packed house in the home of the Blues and the home of Elvis Presley's Graceland. Speed Channel's coverage of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series pre-race show is presented by Craftsman. Beautiful day for the fans in Memphis, Tennessee. 84 degrees, slightly overcast, very slight wind. So a beautiful day for racing. One team looking to have the sun shine on them today is Ultra Motorsports.
In 2003, Memphis was just one of Ted Musgrave's three victories in the Mopar Dodge. But in 2004, this two-truck team has been ultra bad. Their normal 1-2 punch has lacked strength and power. Sean Parker left the team after five races, leaving the task to Gene Need to get this team turned around, and he's done just that in the last two events. Today, it's the first time that Musgrave returns to a track with a truck that has already won before. And that truck is number 28. They call it the CT Special. Of course, this truck won a year ago here at Memphis and also at California. Ted, I know you're glad to have CT back, but tell me about this racetrack. Are you good enough to win today?
Truck's good enough. Hope I am. Yeah. The truck's very competitive. You know, we had a really good qualifying effort. But in the last practice, it was pretty good, too. You know, had the right feel, and that's what you need here, and a lot of adjustability.
You finished second at Texas, excuse me. I know that was disappointing there with what happened with the loose lug nuts. But still, even though you finish second, you lose a couple of points. How tough is it going to be to gain on Dennis Setzer and get back in his title fight?
Well, actually, we came out equal because I led the most laps, and so it wasn't even wash there. But, yeah, you can't catch up by doing that. And like I say, it's just tough. We're way back in points, 12th right now. But these guys ain't going to give up. It's a long way to go.
Okay, Ted Musgrave will roll off second here today. You know, these guys have won 51 times with Dodge, 100 times with Chevy, 66 for Ford. The question is, when will the first victory come for Toyota?
You take 36 trucks, cram them in a short track, and the room for error shrinks infinitely. No one knows that more than Toyota. With almost a third of the season under our belt, it's time to assess how the Tundras stack up. Among our speedway stops, Toyota has an impressive tally of stats. But today, the odds are against them. In two short track races, bad luck and misfortune have shown in their results. Can today be the day Toyota turns their short track program around and achieve that elusive first win? Mike Skinner is one of those Toyota drivers. Mike, you have 16 career victories in the Truck Series. 12 of them come from short tracks, none of them in a seat of a Toyota Tundra. Can you do it today?
Well, we certainly hope so. You know, our Tundra wasn't very good in happy hour, but several of those 16 wins that we got in the Craftsman Truck Series, we wasn't the best truck. So there's about three or four of them up there that's kind of in their own zip code right now, and I feel like they're going to be really hard to beat. But you know, Rick Wren, all the guys with Bang Racing, they work hard on this little Tundra, and the TRD people put us in great, great stuff, and the engine's been running really good. So we're just going to see what we can do with this little piece today. Hopefully we can get a good hot rod by the end of the day.
All right, that's Mike Skinner in a truck called Frank. He finished fifth at Martinsville. Rick Allen?
Well, the four top 10 point standings didn't change this week for the first five, but David Rudeman jumped up five spots to seventh with his third place finish at Texas. Hello, everyone. I'm Rick Allen alongside NASCAR superstar Phil Parsons. And when we go to a short track, you immediately think Dennis Setzer.
Normally you would, because he is the king of the short tracks in the Craftsman Truck Series. He won three times last year. He's already finished second twice this year on the short tracks. But big problems for the 46 Chevrolet in happy hour. He was only 27th fastest in happy hour yesterday afternoon. The team completely tore that truck apart looking for something that might have been wrong, but they really haven't found anything. So they're hoping that they stumbled across it by accident, because they really have nothing they can put their finger on.
Is it a possibility that we're at a three-quarter mile track as opposed to the half-mile tracks that they've had such success this year at?
I really don't think so, because Dennis Setzer has never finished out of the top five at this racetrack. So when they're trying to figure out what's wrong, they can immediately eliminate Dennis Setzer as the problem. So they have to work on the truck, and hopefully they fixed it.
Well, Dennis Setzer, Danny Gill, and the 46 team trying to get a handle on that truck for today's race. Bobby Hamilton, also a very strong truck at Memphis Motorsports Park. The fans are ready for the 225th race at Memphis Motorsports Park. We'll be back with more from Memphis. Speed Channel's coverage of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series pre-race show is brought to you by Craftsman, the official tools of NASCAR and the NHRA. Well, becoming the 44th different winner in NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series history was gratifying for Chad Chaffin, but the path he's taken to get that first win is what he will always remember.
While the race was going on, I really felt like it was in the bag. But I mean, a race is never over. Anything can happen. But those last four or five laps, I had Rick behind me, and I knew I just had a real fast truck. I just had to hit my marks. But once you cross that finish line, and I started, you know, through three and four, and I was getting down to speed to turn on the pit road, it just really hit me right there, you know, wow, this is huge. This is a culmination of a lot of years and a lot of hard work. And I think anytime you wait for something for so long, it's just that much sweeter, and I've really enjoyed it. So I was really fighting back the emotions so that I didn't break down. I heard Cindy was real emotional in the pits, you know, and she's been with me through so much, you know. We're just a partnership in this. And I just sat there in the truck and I thought about all the years I've raced and all the many people who helped me. And unlike a lot of kids now that get started, you know, obviously it takes money to get into the sport. My dad had enough money to get me started. And the first car we had, we brought it home. It was an off-the-street car. I pulled out all the interior and all the windows and I painted it and the whole nine yards. And he taught me actually how to set it up. And we went to the track. You know, he said, tell me what it's doing. And I told him, and he said, here's how you fix it. And there's a lot of guys that race their whole life and never get an opportunity to do the things that I've done to race at Dover or Darlington or Daytona. So I'm very satisfied, and I'm very happy with how everything's gone. I really like where I'm at right now. The BHR team, Bobby Hamilton's been a friend of mine and a huge supporter of mine over the years. And I really like racing for him. I want to stay in the Truck Series. I want to win a championship. I've ridden around in the back. I don't care a thing in the world about that. I like having an opportunity to win races. And I know the paychecks are bigger, but it's not about the money to me. It's more about just accomplishing, winning, being competitive, and I really like the Truck Series.
And that big win at Dover, then a fifth at Texas. I have to wonder, Chad Chaffin, did that make you a better driver getting to victory lane?
Well, you know, I think my driving has been getting better and the trucks have been awesome, but the confidence level is real high. So I think now that I've won one, I think it'll be easier for our Diggs Dodge to find its way back.
Okay, you roll off ninth today. What's going to be the strategy that gets you back to victory lane?
Go to the front, stay there.
What about tires today, though?
Well, we get three sets. We start with a set, two sets in the pits. It's a 200-lap race. Ideally, you like to just kind of spread it out even, you know, because tires are going to wear out here, and we don't want to leave here with any tires left. We want to use all three sets of them up.
Okay, that's Chad Chaffin. Now let's hear from his boss man, Bobby Hamilton.
Well, thanks, Ray. Bobby Hamilton has three starts here and has never finished better than seventh today. You start third on the grid. Bobby, what is your plan of attack for today?
Well, we would like to get up front and lead as quick as possible, but the Square D Dodge was very good all day yesterday and was very good in happy hour. That's the good news. Bad news is it's a different day and it's cooler, so I'm sure everybody's stuff's going to be a little different, which means the track will come to some people and it could affect people that was good yesterday.
Now your son, Bobby Jr., has a victory here last year in the Busch Series. Have you been able to bounce ideas off of each other?
Oh, yeah. A lot of the reason why, he and I talked about this racetrack a lot, and the same thing goes like at Atlanta. When I won a race there, me and him talked, compare notes right after that. So we share a lot of information, and we learned some stuff from him about the tire, the way the tire feels, and things of that nature. And everybody knows this year that's been a beast of its own, getting a handle on this new tire. But we feel real good about it.
All right, that's Bobby Hamilton on Father's Day weekend looking for a victory. Rick, Phil?
Thank you, Wendy. Drivers continue to get ready and prepared for today's race. Again, the fans here at Memphis, a part of history. 225th start for the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series taking place at Memphis. Ted Musgrave has run strong here. He is your defending winner. We'll see if he can do it again at the O'Reilly 200. Welcome to the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series O'Reilly 200 on Speed Channel. Let's go down trackside for the invocation and national anthem.
You've given us to come out to the Memphis Motorsports Park and enjoy the O'Reilly 200. Father God, we pray that your blessings of protection would go on every driver, every team, and every fan that's here today. And we pray that this event would bring you glory today, God. And we ask these things in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, Memphis being the home of rock and roll, and one of the noted songwriters right here right now with our national anthem to celebrate the freedom of this great country is Jimmy Davis.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light, or the ramparts we watch were so gallantly streaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. Oh, the ramparts we watch were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave.
Jimmy Davis, ladies and gentlemen, and once again here at the Memphis Motorsports Park, are you proud to be Americans? How about it?
Please, sun continues to shine over Memphis Motorsports Park for the O'Reilly 200 live on Speed Channel. Come on back. We'll line them up after this. Throughout the 2004 truck season, Craftsman will award a total of 19 autographed toolboxes that will include a full set of tools. These are the same toolboxes that are awarded to the winning truck drivers in Victory Lane. To enter, viewers will guess the winning driver of the upcoming NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series race, which is Milwaukee. All you have to do is go to speedtv.com and enter your winner as well as your information. If selected, you will win your very own stock toolbox autographed by that race's winning driver. Again, to win, you have to log on to speedtv.com and cast your vote. Bill, who's our lucky winner that chose Dennis Setzer in Texas?
Rick, we had a bunch of fans vote for Dennis Setzer to win the Texas race last week. Unfortunately, we can only have one winner, and that person is Brett Johnson of Jasper, Georgia. Congratulations, Brett. And fans, we still have 17 toolboxes to give away, so make sure to log on to speedtv.com and pick your winner.
Well, if you believe in history repeating itself, Setzer would be a good choice for this race. We take a look at his marks from Memphis Motorsports Park. Fifth, third, first, fifth, third. Well, you can almost think that first might follow that. Let's find out. Standing by with Dennis Setzer's Ray Dunlap.
Well, thank you, Rick. And the last two times that they've run this truck, it finished second in our first two short track races this year. Dennis, I know happy hour was a little perplexing for you. How is that on your psyche as you get ready to start this race?
Well, it'll be great for us. You know, I know Danny Gill makes all the right calls. The guys check back over the truck, and everything was 110% on the setup. So, you know, we'll go from there. Danny always makes the right adjustments. We'll just, I'll tell him they know what he's doing, and we'll make some adjustments from there.
Okay, good luck. That is Dennis Setzer, and now let's check in with Wendy.
Well, thanks, Ray. 4 years ago, Jack Sprague won this race, and that day he started in the fifth spot, the deepest in the field anyone went on to win. Today, he starts in position number one. Jack, you've been happy with your truck all weekend. What do you have for today?
Well, I tell you, if I have what I had yesterday, I'll probably be in pretty good shape. But the guys have done a great job, man. This Chevy truck, Chevrolet, came off the hauler awesome. It was awesome all day, awesome in qualifying, and awesome in happy hours. So Man, this is the best thing I've ever had here to drive, and hopefully it'll be that way today and we can go on and win this thing.
Now, we were talking, the win from the pole bonus is $16,000 today. Can the 16 truck take it? Win from the pole, the highest it's ever been. That's kind of a good incentive today.
Yeah, it's pretty cool, too. It's number 16 truck, so if we could win that thing, it'd be awesome. But just, the biggest thing is the big picture and just do the best we can with what we have. And if, like I said, if we have what we had yesterday, we got a shot at it. If not, we'll take what we can get.
All right, Jack Sprague, he won our last short track visit. Let's go to Ray Dunlap.
Thank you, Wendy. Ready to talk to Carl Edwards in his Super Chips Ford here. He'll roll off fourth today. Carl, what's going to be the secret to winning this race?
I'll tell you what, track position is going to be the biggest thing, Ray. I watched the race from last year, and the top five ran together almost the whole race. So I think to get this Super Chips Ford up front in the victory circle, we're going to have to be up front after the last pit stop. I got a great group of guys, though, and I've got a lot of confidence in them. So happy Father's Day to everybody out there early, and, man, I'd like to bring a trophy home for Dad.
Tell me, what is the latest that you can pit today? What do you think it's going to be?
Boy, I'm telling you, it's going to be pretty early. I wouldn't come in with anything more than probably 50 to go or something because it's so hard to pass. So, but who knows? Somebody could blow that out of the water if they had a good enough truck. We'll hopefully be the ones to do it.
Okay, good luck today. That's Carl Edwards. Now let's check back in with Wendy.
Well, Shane Meehl has 2 sixth-place finishes but 3 DNFs to go along with it this season. Shane, your truck has been fast all weekend. Can this be a turnaround weekend for Billy Ballou Motorsports starting from the sixth spot?
I think it can. The Spondivitz Alfredo self-storage Chevrolets, it's been good all weekend, and we just had a lot of bad luck. We got a fast truck every week, and we're going to do the best thing we can to get in victory lane today.
All right, thanks, Shane. Let's go trackside.
The command was given for the engines to fire. The fans are fired up. They're about to see another great race in the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series. We'll be back to see the seventh race at Memphis Motorsports Park. It's the O'Reilly 200 on speed. The NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series O'Reilly 200 on Speed Channel is brought to you by Craftsman, the official tools of NASCAR and the NHRA. And by the next Ford F-150, 2004 Motor Trend Truck of the Year. Last Monday, June 14th, was the 227th observance of Flag Day. Americans everywhere also use this week to celebrate the 229th birthday of the U.S. Army. Race fans everywhere, NASCAR and the American Forces Network cherish the soldiers that protect our freedom. We also want to recognize those soldiers that work to rebuild the schools, hospitals, and roads that will soon allow the people of Iraq to pursue their own liberties and freedom. Now we turn to the U.S. Army starting grid. On the pole, a record 22nd career pole. All three short tracks on the pole this season, Jack Sprague. Outside of him, Ted Musgrave, last year's winner. He led 102 laps here. Bobby Hamilton with his best qualifying effort this year in third.
Travis Quappel starts on the inside of row three, a former winner here and our defending series champion.
Chad Chaffin, Dover winner. Just from Nashville, Tennessee, only 3 hours down the road from here.
Their short track king, Dennis Setzer, on the outside of row number five.
Rick Crawford's first short track win was at Martinsville earlier this year. He'll start 14th.
See Andy Houston on the outside of row number nine. Let's see if we can talk to Andy. Andy Houston, Phil Parsons up in the speed booth. Can you hear me? Andy, have that thing turned around here. A couple top tens the last two times out. Can you keep it going today?
I sure hope so. The Team ASE Carquest Dodge has not been too bad since we've been here. We were really good yesterday morning in practice, and then we lost a little bit there qualifying, and ended up being 18th. But we feel like we got a really good truck for today, and this is a long race, and it seems like track position and pit strategy come into play, so I think we'll have as good a shot as anybody.
All right, Andy, good luck, buddy.
Four.
The Craftsman track description for Memphis Motorsports Park. You mentioned 3/4 of a mile oval. And the three-quarter or the race analysis, Craftsman race analysis, 36 trucks will be starting today.
It's a lot of traffic on a short three-quarter of a mile track, 200 laps, purse over $500,000. Pit window for fuel will be about 100 to 120 laps, but nobody thinks it'll go that long. They think there'll be some caution flags, so guys will be in here earlier for tires. Here's a track description, three-quarters of a mile, 11-degree banking in the corners, 4 degrees down the straightaways, front stretch, back stretch about 1,100 feet, very tight corners, a lot of brakes at this racetrack.
We talked to Andy Houston. We'll also be riding on board with Andy in the Team ASC CarQuest Dodge. Again, he starts 18th, so we'll watch him pick his way through the field.
Mike Skinner, our inaugural series champion back in 1995, will start his Toyota Tundra from the 11th position.
Right along with Dennis Setzer, Chevy Silverado, number 46. He'll start in 10th position. Kind of an important statistic. No one has ever won out of the top five starting positions. So if Dennis Setzer is able to dominate the short track, he would do it from a place that no one else has won before.
There's John Wood, and Jack Roush is 40. He won on a short track last year at Martinsville, so he knows his way around these kind of short tracks.
I was just going to say the Craftsman win from the pole award, possibly going to Jack Sprague. He can win $16,000 for his team. If Jack does not win from the pole today, then another $2,000 will be added to the prize money. Purse grows in increments of $2,000 until someone wins that award. $50,000 is available to the teams this season for the Craftsman win from the pole award.
Let's see if we can talk to Mike Skinner driving that Toyota. Mike Skinner, Phil Parsons up in the speed booth. Can you hear me?
A lot of people have picked.
10-4 on the fans.
Mike Skinner, can you hear me?
I got you, buddy.
You told our Wendy that your truck wasn't very good and happy hour. Have you made a bunch of changes to that Toyota?
We made just a few little subtle changes. We changed the left front spring, changed the wedge a little bit, track bar. We've been a little bit lost since we got here. Hopefully this little Tundra will carry us on up through there. I know I got a heck of a pit crew that'll, if I can pass half of them, those boys can pass the rest of them.
All right, Mike, good luck.
Thank you, guys. Have a good day.
Again, Mike Skinner will be trying to work his way past 10 trucks. He starts 11th back in row 6. Some veterans up front. Jack Sprague, series champion, three-time series champion, sits on the pole. And he leads the field with Ted Musgrave on his outside as Dennis James has the green flag. And we are about to go racing at Memphis Motorsports Park.
Side-by-side racing. We didn't see a whole lot of that in happy hour yesterday. Most of the trucks wanted to get right to the bottom of the racetrack.
Jack Sprague jumped out in front of Ted Musgrave on the start, and he will lead lap number one as they come by the start finish line for the first time. Jack Sprague actually led the most laps in both short track races this season.
This is his third short track race, and he started from the pole in all three of them, two of them by qualifying, and one of them by virtue of the fact that qualifying was rained out, and he started over by last year's car owner points, or truck owner points, which his truck was the champion last year.
On board with John Wood as we take a look back at that Toyota, and then look forward at John Wood riding along with Mike Skinner.
Very important to hit your marks down here in the corner. You go very, very fast down the front straightaway, which you see Bobby Hamilton move to the inside of the one truck of Ted Musgrave, but it's a front straightaway has a little bit of a turn to it, but you want to be positioned where you can get a good angle, maybe a late entrance into the corner to keep that truck turning through the center.
Bobby Hamilton moves into the second position, moving ahead of Ted Musgrave early. Bobby Hamilton was very, very strong in happy hour.
Boy, he sure was. Up and down the garage here, you talked to all the crew chiefs and said, hey, the Ford truck is the one we're going to have to beat. The 16 truck is extremely good. Look at Ted Musgrave go way wide. He's going to lose one spot to Carl Edwards, and now Shane Meal looks to the inside. Ted shuts the door.
Now, Shane Meal in practice and even in qualifying, we talked about how loose that truck looked coming off the corner.
We talked to Richie Waters, his crew chief, right before the race, and he said, hey, we were a little bit too loose, more so coming off turn four than turn two, but we've worked on the truck. We think we have it a lot better. Looks pretty straight so far as he's able to move by Ted Musgrave.
We talked about how Musgrave was trying to get rid of all the bad vibes they had at Ultra Motorsports, and it looks as though the Mopar Dodge is moving the wrong direction.
He's definitely backing up. He, again, was one of the trucks that everyone said was really, really good in happy hour, but he's got all these other trucks he's racing with were also good in happy hour, so that's... It's going to be a very, very competitive race, I think. There's a lot of good trucks here. Again, Dennis Setzer, our short track king, was 27th fastest in happy hour. That shows how the competition is.
When you had mentioned earlier about Bobby Hamilton and how much everyone was talking about that truck being so good, he's always been good here. He just hasn't had great finishes because of mechanical problems.
Yes, nothing wrong with his setup. It's just he hasn't been able to try to get to the finish with his truck. But he's chasing down Jack Sprague right now. He's definitely the fastest truck on the racetrack.
He is definitely closing the gap between himself and leader Jack Sprague. Just 0.4 seconds separated them the last time by.
See Bobby able to get in the throttle in the center of the corner. That's where he gained that ground. He gained probably 0.75 truck length right in the center of the corner, and that's very critical. His truck is turning extremely well. Watch, let's see if he can try to turn under Jack Sprague and try to beat him off the corner.
Where do you pass on a track like this, Phil?
The best place to pass is to try to get your truck turned in the middle, as we're talking about. Try to get underneath somebody, especially coming off turn number 4. You have a little more room at the exit of turn 4 right there. Bobby's not able to do it yet, but that's how you really want to try to pass somebody, is be able to drive up underneath and coming up to the corner and then beat him down to the next corner.
At the start of the race, we saw side-by-side racing. Everyone staying in line through the first lap almost. Now it's starting to spread out to where they're getting in single file. But will drivers go up on that second groove and try to pass on the outside?
Well, I think they will. I talked to Jack Sprague before the race. He said, hey, can you pass on the outside? He said, yeah, I passed, you know, maybe not Bobby Hamilton on the outside, but I passed some pretty good trucks, and I was able to make some pretty good time on the outside, especially through 3 and 4. So I think we may see some passing. There's our 46 truck right there.
And he's making passes right now as he went by Robert Huffman and took over the 6th place position. And it looks as though possibly Danny Gill and the 46 team has got that truck figured out.
But when we talked to Dennis before the race, he was so confident in his guys. They've made such good adjustments this year. They've won 2 super speedway races on the mile and a half and 2nd of the 2 short tracks, as we mentioned. So they're good everywhere we go. And it looks like so far they made the right adjustments.
Jack Sprague has led all 11 laps. This will be his 12th as he goes by the start finish line. In Memphis Motorsports Park for the O'Reilly 200, Jack Sprague in front of hard-charging Bobby Hamilton. Folks, Father's Day is tomorrow, and you have 1 day left to take advantage of Sears National Sales Campaign Good Life, Great Race. Again, that ends tomorrow. You can purchase qualifying items at Sears and be able to purchase a NASCAR limited edition DVD for just $4.99, under $5 for this DVD, NASCAR, A Family Tradition. A great product right there. But you can also enter their sweepstakes, which enables you to win a new 2004 Ford F-150 with the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series paint scheme, like the one you see on the screen right now, Rick Crawford's Sears number 14. It's a beautiful truck. You have tomorrow to get qualified for that, to get signed up, so make sure you stop into Sears for that Good Life, Great Race promotion. Rick Crawford currently running in the 12th position. Jack Sprague continues to lead. Bobby Hamilton still just about 0.2 to 0.3 seconds behind as they close in on slower lap traffic.
Right now, Bobby Hamilton does not need to push the issue. You see if he peeks to the outside, now Jack Sprague goes that way. But Bobby does not need to push the issue. He knows this is a long race. He's got a lot of the Nextel Cup mentality. He knows that he's got to get 200 laps. This race is not going to be won on lap 20, lap 25, lap 50. He knows what it takes to get to the end of the race.
Great battle for 6th and 7th. Robert Huffman, Travis Quaffle, Quaffle on the inside. And right behind him, Matt, right along with Travis Quaffle as they try to get by that Toyota.
Good shot. That's Mike Skinner. We're watching from his onboard. You see the Toyota. Robert Huff on the outside. He's going to open the door for Mike Skinner. Two very, very similar trucks.
That was a great shot, because you can see the curving that's on the track. A lot of drivers say that they make a mistake and get onto that curving, and it'll take away a little bit of the traction for their truck.
For those of you that watched the Formula One qualifying today, you know how those drivers run over the curbs. You don't want to do that at this racetrack here with these trucks.
Shane Meal makes the pass around Bobby Hamilton and gets in front of him for second. Now he sets his sights on the 16 of Jack Sprague.
Now, I don't think Shane will be quite as patient as Bobby Hamilton, because Shane Meal needs to get up there. He wants to get that 15 truck up front, lead this race if he can, to attract some attention. They've got a great team going. Great Dunlop, let's go more on the 15.
Well, Phil, I just wanted to add about next weekend at Milwaukee, Shane Meal will be very busy there. He'll be driving this 15 truck and also the number 38 Busch Grand National car that Casey Kane normally drives. They have a schedule conflict, so they said, we want to get somebody that's a great short track driver. They put Shane Meal in that seat next week. Now, Bobby Hamilton wanted to be patient. He saw how quick that 15 was coming, so he just pulled over to the inside on the front stretch and let Shane Meal go by. Figured he can go up there and race with Sprague. Bobby's going to lay back and just watch for a while.
And here it is.
Watch Bobby Hamilton there. As Ray mentioned, he's just going to pull over, let Shane Meal go by. Again, why not let the 15 of Shane Meal go up there and pressure Jack Sprague, be all over Jack Sprague, make Jack look in the mirror, and Bobby Hamilton just riding, just saving his equipment.
You know, Bobby Hamilton, I talked to him yesterday before they went out for their last practice, made the comment, you know what, this is a track where young guys and very anxious guys can really get hurt, because you don't have to go full throttle around this track. Problems, caution flag has come out for the first time at Memphis Motorsports Park. We're hearing from NASCAR debris on the front stretch. Brings out caution number one. After 26 laps in Memphis, Tennessee, the O'Reilly 200 is under caution for the first time. Yesterday, a group of drivers got together to bring some smiles to some very special race fans. The drivers visited the St. Jude Children's Research Hospital, located here in downtown Memphis. St. Jude is one of the largest research hospitals dedicated to pediatric cancer in America. Certainly a special day for these kids, full of smiles and laughter. And talking with the drivers yesterday, it was clearly a special day for everyone involved. Mike Skinner, Travis Quaple were involved with that. They brought along nine other drivers, so Bang Racing kind of spearheaded that trip to St. Jude, and a great, great trip for all the drivers and kids involved.
The Craftsman Truck Series drivers go to a lot of hospitals in the areas that we go to where the races are held, always willing to give up their time, especially when kids are involved.
The debris has been in the front stretch. A few trucks came in to top off with a few adjustments on this first caution. None of our leaders came down pit road. Wendy, what happened?
Well, the two truck of Andy Houston decided to pit on lap 27. They were loose in and tight in the middle, and he had absolutely no grip coming off, he said. So they took four tires and fuel and went up two rounds on the right-hand side and a half rubber out of the right rear.
Pretty early pit stop to put tires on. I saw a lot of the drivers that came in just made adjustments, put fuel in them, but Andy Houston changing four tires, that only leaves him with really one more set of tires to put on during this race.
Pitting this early, we had talked about during the Craftsman race analysis, the pit window being anywhere from 100 to 120 laps for fuel. Is this something where 25 laps into it, they put on tires? Could they be in trouble having the limited number?
Well, it depends on how the cautions fall. Most of the teams were talking about hopefully getting a caution around lap 50 to 60, and then maybe another one around lap 110, and that would be the only pit stops. Now, obviously, this is a little bit early, Andy pitting before lap 30, but if the caution comes out in 15 laps and everybody else comes into pits, then he's going to have great track position, and he won't have that many more laps on the tires. But if we get a long green flag run, then that would be different, obviously.
We've seen that winning up front is almost synonymous with Memphis. How important is it to get up front?
Well, you definitely have to be up front at the end of the race to win. So these drivers want to stay up front. And again, Andy was so far back, he was running in about 17th or 18th position when the caution flag came out. So he felt like it was going to be more advantageous to him to adjust on his truck, put four tires on his. They said, hey, we know we're putting them on early, but we need to adjust our truck to try to get our truck better. He's going to have a little more opportunity. If he gets another caution flag in lap 50 or 60, he may come back in and adjust on it some more because they were a little bit off at the start.
Andy Houston started the race in 18th position. And you saw the graphic earlier that no one has won this race from outside the top five starting positions.
And ironically, the fastest three trucks, or what the fastest three trucks that everybody talked about, all started in the top three positions. So that really seems like it may hold that that you have to be in the top five to win this race.
We talked about Ted Musgrave dropping back a ways. He dropped back to fifth position. Andy Houston again making that stop has dropped to 26th.
Hey folks, guess what? If you haven't checked your calendar, tomorrow's Father's Day. And here's a great gift for Dad, the Craftsman Shop Phone. What I love about this thing is it's made of high-impact durable plastic, so if you drop it, it doesn't even break. And also has a great belt clip so you can go out and mow the yard and take your phone right with you. It has a very big range so you can use it all the way around your shop or anywhere at your house. And I also love that it comes with an extra battery which snaps right here onto the base station so you're never going to run out of power. Make sure you give your dad a call tomorrow and say, guess what, Pops? I got a shop phone on the way.
Well, hopefully Ray will call his dad with that exact message tomorrow.
Will he give him a shop phone?
Well, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Guess what, Dad? I got a shop phone on the way. A couple father sons in NASCAR that will be enjoying Father's Day. Bobby Hamilton Jr., those two, as well as the Labonte's.
So Justin Labonte, Bobby Jr. will be in the Busch race in Kentucky later on this evening, and tomorrow the Cup race up in Michigan.
Jack Sprague still out in front of the field as he leads them to the start-finish line, and we restart the O'Reilly 200. Bobby Hamilton running in third behind Shane Meal and Jack Sprague.
See if Shane Meal can do anything with Jack Sprague. I know Shane would like to get up there and lead this race.
How anxious can you get? If you're Shane Meal, do you go after Jack Sprague right away to try to get by, or do you do what Bobby Hamilton was doing, just sit back and let him lead the race?
Again, I think Shane Meal is young, and this race team hadn't had a tremendous amount of success, so they would like to get up there and be out front and get some TV time leading this race. So I think Shane Meal is going to do all he can do to try to get up there. Now, I don't think he's going to go up there and knock Jack Sprague out of the way because he's a pretty smart driver, but he would love to get by Jack Sprague. But see, Jack doesn't make very many mistakes, so he's not going to slip up and allow Shane Meal to get by him.
Back in traffic, we mentioned he had made that stop, dropped all the way back to 26th. Now he's moved up to 23rd.
A lot of traffic there. You see Brandon Witt, the 38 truck. He's another one of the trucks that pitted on that caution flag. He was able to slide by Andy on the inside.
Houston trying to get by Tracy Hines in the Menards 88, just to his outside. And look at the two yellow stripes in front of him.
Got a lap truck
right in front of him.
Lap truck of Terry McDonald in the 72. So Andy's going to get blocked in behind her. He had to let Tracy Hines go by on the outside, pull up behind him. Now he needs to get back in the throttle, try to get by the lap truck, and then work over Tracy Hines.
Houston slides to the outside. Preferred line around this track down towards the dirt.
Right on the bottom of the racetrack. That's the place everyone wants to be. You saw Andy on the outside. He was, as he was going by the lap truck, and lost a little bit of ground to Tracy Hines. And remember, Andy's one of the trucks that pitted on that caution along with Tracy Hines, but we know Andy got four tires. I don't think Tracy Hines put any tires on that caution flag.
Yesterday we had a practice, they qualified, and then we had our second practice, or happy hour. But last night it rained. So does that take away any types of feel that these drivers had for this track coming into the race today?
Well, it definitely took some of the rubber off the racetrack. So the racetrack was probably more like when they got here yesterday morning before that two-hour practice session prior to qualifying. And it's about 10 degrees cooler today than it was yesterday. So the track temperature is definitely not as hot as it was yesterday. got a great battle for the leader. Looked like Shane Meal might have gotten the back of Jack Sprague a little bit. Not enough to move him out of the way.
It looks as though Shane Meal and Bobby Hamilton are running faster than Jack Sprague right now, but they just don't have a way to get around him.
Well, Jack right now, he knows he's got the lead, and he's got the preferred line in the bottom of the racetrack. So why use your equipment to try to drive away from this much? He needs to try to run just fast enough to stay in front of these guys.
And as we talked about the woes of practice from yesterday, Dennis Setzer has moved up into the sixth spot just behind Ted Musgrave as we ride along with him.
It does appear that Jack Sprague may be holding that group up behind him a little bit, but again, he's got the advantage of being able to have clear racetrack. He can run wherever he wants to run, and it's up to those guys to try to make their way around him.
With more than Dennis Setzer, Ray Dunlop.
Guys, I just wanted to let you know, right before we got ready to roll off today, Dennis Setzer added a bunch of rear brake to his truck. He said, I think the track conditions are changing from what we had expected. He said, if I get real loose later, I can change that. But he probably added at least 6 rounds of rear brake to that truck.
Phil, we've seen it every year of the Craftsman Truck Series. They are won by being able to get up to the front. If you don't have a good truck, you make it better to get up to the front.
We've seen that in the last few weeks in the Nextel Cup Series. Dale Earnhardt Jr. did not have a very good car in the last 2 or 3 races. He was able to get the free pass, worked his way back up into a top 5 position. That's how championships are won. These drivers, these teams are doing the exact same thing. Dennis Setzer was out to lunch in happy hour, as we talked about earlier. 22nd fastest, and here he is running 6, keeping up with the leaders the entire race, and we've run 45 laps.
Top 10 finishes, extremely valuable when you're hunting for a championship. And so with Dennis Setzer running as strong as he is right now, he's probably feeling comfortable with his truck.
Well, he really is, but I'm sure he's going to be talking to Danny Gill. Ooh, looked like Carl Edwards got a little loose coming off turn 4. May have made a little contact with the outside wall. This racetrack is really susceptible to getting loose lane, which means you are straight, and you want to get the power down as much as you can, and then you can spin the wheels, actually, when you're almost off the corner going straight. And that's what happened to Carl Edwards that time. Looked like he got a little bit loose right at the very exit of the corner right there.
With more on Ted Musgrave, Winnie Norris.
Our defending winner, Ted Musgrave, he started on the front row for the second straight week in a row. When I talked to him this morning, he said, don't expect me to stay up there very long. I'm going to take it easy and be very careful today. He is racing this truck next week in Milwaukee. This is also the same truck he won with 1 year ago. Memphis. They decided to not pit on that last caution, but you can bet you might see him come in the next stop.
As you had mentioned, Carl Edwards got a little loose coming out of 4. We look back at that mishap as he came out of 4.
Again, he's going to come off the corner. He's going to get up late. I mean, he's almost going exactly straight, but perfectly straight, and he actually just runs up. He did not really get loose. It looks like he almost lost the front end, but a lot of times that can be deceptive. He may have been losing the rear end and just chased the truck up the hill, made some contact with the outside wall, but did not really seem to affect the truck at all.
Jack Sprague moving around slower lap traffic. Shane Meal, Bobby Hamilton in tow. Sprague moved from 11th to 6th in points in the last 2 races. 9th at Dover and 4th at Texas.
Bobby Hamlin took a peek to the outside that time. It looked like he may want to see if the outside group was there. It looked like he got some pretty good grip up there. Wasn't able quite to drive up on the outside of Shane Meal, but he may be trying it out for later.
Jack Sprague, Shane Meal, Bobby Hamilton, looking as though they've got a rope between them, staying together as a pack. Memphis Motorsports Park. NBS 24/7. NBS Speed Channel Monday at 8 p.m. Go behind the scenes from checkered to green. The real world of NASCAR Busch Series racing. Watch drivers like Casey Kane, Tim Fedewa, and David Streming. NBS 24/7. Monday at 8. We'll be right back with more racing on Speed. Let's take a closer look at the Premier Division of NASCAR in our Nextel Cup update. Take a look at the starting lineup for the Michigan race for the Cup.
Pole winner Jeff Gordon leads the Hendrick sweep of the top three positions. Brian Vickers and Jimmy Johnson, who's been so hot lately. Two races out of the last three or four he's won. Tremendous run going right now. Robbie Gordon, a great run. And Richard Childress's 31 car back in fifth.
Our full weekend of racing action continues tonight. Nextel Cup practice from Michigan, followed by Busch Series Racing, presented by Subway from Kentucky on FX. Tomorrow it's Nextel Cup Racing on Fox as Kurt Busch looks to defend his title against the world's best drivers, followed by Speed News and NASCAR Victory Lane on Speed. NASCAR continues all weekend long across the Fox networks. Up front, we have a new leader. Shane Meal has made the pass on Jack Sprague, and that makes it the third different track that he has led at this year. He only led one lap at Daytona and one lap at Texas.
Let's see if we can take a look at how he was able to make that pass. And he's opened up a pretty good gap right now over Jack Sprague. See him coming off turn number four. As we talked earlier, you want to try to get underneath somebody coming off turn number four, beat him down to the next corner. That's exactly what Shane Meal was able to do.
Battle for fourth, fifth, and sixth. Matt Crafton getting into the mix of it with Carl Edwards.
Looks like that 46 truck of Dennis Setzer in front of both of these trucks. Right now, Dennis moving up to the fifth position. It's amazing what Danny Gillen has bunched in, because we stayed at the same motel as them, and every one of those guys said they did not sleep last night, going through notes, trying to figure out what was wrong with that truck. And so far, the changes they've made have been right on.
The 15's been running some extremely fast laps. Ray, what's going on?
Well, Rick, I just wanted to make a comment real quick about his pit crew. The guys that will be going over the wall for the 15 today, not a bunch of young guns like you'd expect. These guys, most of them over 35, guys like Mike Brown and his crew chief Richie Waters, Jerry Greathouse, and a bunch of the guys down here. The over the 35 group, they call them. Now, Shane, of course, is only 24 years old. They're all rooting him on. You see crew chief Richie Waters on top of the box. When he comes in for his first round of pit stops, a bunch of old guys going to give him service.
I kind of take offense at that. I'm 35. I don't know if I would consider myself old.
I thought that was pretty young, actually.
I did, too. This is the first race or truck race for Shane Meal at Memphis Motorsports Park, but he has run a Busch race.
He sure has. He ran a couple years ago, finished 11th in the Busch race back in 2002, so he has experience on this racetrack. This is his first season in the truck series and never ran any races prior to this year, but doing a terrific job. When they haven't had mechanical trouble, they have been right up front.
Here's Vang Racing. 8th, 9th, and 10th. Line X 24 of Travis Quaffle in front of Mike Skinner. And now Chad Chaffin trying to take away the spot from Skinner. And we saw this earlier. Chad Chaffin was just behind Mike Skinner looking to make the pass now.
Chad Chaffin was another one of the trucks that was very good in happy hour last night. And we must say that happy hour was abbreviated last night. Typically, they get a full hour. Last night, they only got 30 minutes because qualifying went long. So here you see Rick Crawford move to the inside.
So Mike Skinner looks as though those problems continue that he was having earlier. Wendy, what's going on?
Well, pretty much all is quiet on the radio right now. Rick Wren told me this morning, though, that track position was more important than their tires, and he was not going to make the same mistake he made last week at Texas by staying out. So his strategy today is to follow the leader. When the leader's pit, he will be coming in to make those adjustments today.
Skinner trying to put him down another position. Mike currently is being shown in the 11th position. John Wood trying to take that away. We're in a window right now, Rick. We've run 67 laps. So we're in a window when the caution comes out. I think you're going to see all the leaders on pit road and probably some of the drivers that pitted on that first caution flag. Ray Dunlap, what do you have down there?
Hey, Phil, I just wanted to talk a little bit about fuel strategy. Keep in mind, this race normally has at least 8 cautions in it for around 40-some laps. But all I hear on the radio down here now is guys starting to talk about fuel mileage. How far can they go? Of course, we saw that caution come out in the mid-20s there, and just a few trucks came down for pit road for service. But the big question is now, how long will these guys be able to stretch it? Because some of them are not really sure about fuel mileage, just because, like you talked about, with a short happy hour.
Ray, you're exactly right. I talked to a lot of the teams down there, and they said, well, we really don't know exactly how far we can go with fuel. We haven't figured it out yet, because they never dreamed that we would get such a long green flag run here. But again, we've run 70 laps, and some of these drivers that maybe aren't getting as good a fuel mileage as some of the others may have to start thinking about pitting around. around lap 90, at least by lap 100. So I'm sure there's some pretty anxious moments down there in the pits because they know those trucks that pitted on lap 28 have, you know, 28 more laps that they can run on fuel.
Well, Shane Meal continues to put distance between himself and second place. Over 3 seconds now between Meal and Sprague in the O'Reilly 200 on speed.
Driver of the quarter.
And back in Memphis, Tennessee, Shane Meal putting a lot of distance between himself and the field. Over 4.5 seconds now, Shane Meal has put between himself and Jack Sprague.
This is the third short track of the season. The previous two short track races, Shane Meal ran well, finished 35th, and both of them had mechanical trouble. So he's looking to redeem himself and this team, and he's doing a great job of it right now.
Billy Blue, the team owner of that truck, obviously very happy with the performance so far. Jack Sprague tries to hold off the one of Ted Musgrave, and that's a battle for second.
Great battle for second and third. Ted Musgrave's been on Jack Sprague's bumper for the last number of laps here. Over a 4.5 second lead now for Shane Meal, and they were just nose to tail just a few laps ago, it seems.
We talked earlier about Jack Sprague looking almost as though he was holding up Shane Meal and Bobby Hamilton, Ted Musgrave, and now you see where Ted Musgrave is trying to find a line around Jack Sprague. Can Jack Sprague be backing up to where they've got to make some major changes?
Well, I think they definitely will have to make some changes. He's right now holding Ted Musgrave up. See, Ted looked to the inside just as he was holding Shane Meal up, because Shane squirted out to a 4 or 5 second lead. And Dennis Setzer, the guy that struggled so much, is currently being shown in the fourth position. But maybe that is a struggle for Dennis Setzer, because we're used to seeing him up front first or second.
We mentioned that no time before at Memphis Motorsports Park has anyone won from outside the fifth starting position. And Shane Meal started sixth today.
He's got it going his way right now. There's a great battle right now. There's fourth, Dennis Setzer with the 46 Silverado. And there's the sixth truck of Matt Crafton doing a great job. Big time loose off the corner for Dennis Setzer.
It looked as though Matt Crafton was trying to make that pass there and then opted to back off and let Dennis get in front of him so he could take a different line. Here it goes again on the inside. Matt Crafton makes the pass on Dennis Setzer.
Matt showed a lot of patience there. Instead of pushing the issue when Dennis was having some trouble getting off turn two, said, hey, let me wait for this. I'll wait for the right opportunity. I know I can probably get him the next corner, as much as Dennis is struggling right now. And he is struggling right now. How about that sixth of Matt Crafton, Wendy?
Yep, Bill, talking to Wally Rogers this morning, he said he was pretty excited the last two races. They have a new spotter, and that spotter is Rick Corelli. He said he has been a big help to both him and driver Matt Crafton. It's given Wally a lot of confidence, bouncing ideas off of him, and it's also given driver Matt Crafton confidence on the track. You hear Rick Corelli coaching Matt Crafton around one truck at a time. I asked Wally when they plan on pitting. If it stays green, he said lap 115.
Matt Crafton driving that Kevin Harvick-owned Goodwrench Chevrolet, number six.
We talk about how important spotters are, and they are the driver's eyes. There's trouble on the racetrack, but when you can have somebody like the high plains drifter of Rick Corelli spotting for you, that has been here, that has won races in the Craftsman Truck Series, what a big advantage that is for Matt Crafton.
12th position being held by Steve Park, New Orleans Samtown 62. Just behind him, that 42 of Mike Skinner. So Steve Park making the move. Side by side for second, Ted Musgrave on the inside.
Ted finally able to drive up on the inside of Jack Sprague. Let's see if he can jump in the throttle and beat him off the corner. Does it fairly easily.
Ted Musgrave making the pass, and Jack Sprague will drop back to third.
Let's see if Ted Musgrave can drive away from Jack Sprague just like Shane Meal did earlier.
5.5 seconds separate Shane Meal and Ted Musgrave. Now we'll see if Ted Musgrave has as strong as a truck as he had last year at this track.
It'll be interesting to see if he can close the gap now on Shane Meal. Jack Sprague was obviously slowing down Ted Musgrave. So now Ted Musgrave has opened up about a 5-truck-length lead. Wendy, how about Ted Musgrave?
Well, you know how quiet Gene Need is on top of the pit box. I asked him when they planned on pitting, and he just shrugged his shoulders. Typical Gene Need, but Ted Musgrave is moving up through the pack. Spotter Eddie Thrapp is working him one truck at a time around, and he just came over the radio and said, don't worry, Ted, we'll get that 15 truck on pit lane when we come in for a pit stop.
up running in second, trying to turn around this 2004 singing or season. Hopefully not going to sing the blues in Memphis anymore.
Yeah, great run last week at Texas. They had a loose wheel that really kept them from winning that race. Had a good run at Dover. He had a top five truck at Dover, but due to some pit strategy and some people staying out on a long green flag run, he was not able to get the finish that he deserves. But I think that team has definitely turned a corner.
Gene Need coming back to Ultra Motorsports. Shane Meal now trying to put Tracy Hines in the 88 a lap down. Meal continues to run around 24 and a half second laps. Ted Musgrave running about 3/10 of a second faster. We'll see if he can catch it when we come back. Race 9 of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series comes to you from the Milwaukee Mile. It's next Friday, June 25th, 8 p.m. Eastern. Speed Channel will be there from start to finish. Tough trucks, tough racing. Speed Channel has all the action live. June 25th, 8 p.m.
Rick, don't look now, but that 5.5 second lead that Shane Meal had is down to just over 2 seconds. Ted Musgrave has really gained on Shane Meal because Shane has been having some trouble with lap traffic. He's been behind Tracy Hines for a number of laps. Lost about 3.5 seconds of his lead.
Battle for 15th and 16th. Andy Houston running in the 16th spot, trying to get by the 75. David Starr just in front of him. Brandon went behind him. Shane Meal, as you had mentioned, having troubles getting around Tracy Hines. That's closed the gap now that Ted Musgrave is under 2.5 seconds away from Shane Meal. So he's made up 3 seconds since the pass was made.
Shane Meal is able to run about a 24:30 or 40 when he has clean racetrack. Right now, he's running about a 24:80 because he's hung up behind the lap track of Tracy Hines. Actually, Tracy Hines is right now on the tail end of the lead lap, so he's technically not a lead lap truck. He is trying his best to stay on the lead lap, and that's why he's working so hard keeping Shane Meal behind him.
Hey, Phil, I just wanted to add to that. Remember, Tracy Hines is one of the guys that pitted there on lap 26. He only put on right side tires and made a track bar adjustment because he was a little bit too tight. But those fresh right side tires are helping him stay up in front of the leader. Now, we expect Shane Meal to come down at lap 105 for his first pit stop. And the caution is out now, so that will set it up for these guys all to head to pit road. We'll get busy here in just a second.
And as we pass the halfway point, 101 laps complete, the second caution comes out, I believe, for Brad Keselowski in the number 29 truck.
Saw a lot of smoke out of the back of the 29 truck. See the smoke right now out of the back of the truck.
See if we can see what happened as we go by in Andy Houston's truck.
See a lot of smoke out of the back of Brad Keselowski's truck. See him pulled up the inside.
Engine woes again. Yeah. For the 29th.
They have not been able to buy a break. They had a great run going at Dover, lost an engine, made hard contact, probably lost that truck completely. Brad made a going to make the hard left-hand turn into the garage area. Tough break for the K Automotive team.
Smoke continues to roll out of that truck. Now, that closes the gap that was 2.5 seconds. Shane Meal will be just in front of Ted Musgrave. And Phil, are we going to see pit stops now?
We're going to see pit stops, and as Ray mentioned, we're going to have the over 35 crew of Shane Meal see if he can maintain this lead on pit road. But this is when the people on pit road, the teams, really earn their keep. We've got a caution flag. We're halfway. This could be the only pit stop. Right now, track position is critical. Whoever wins the race off pit road will have a slight advantage.
We've seen troubles in the pits already this season. These teams are trying to focus right now as they know that next time by, their trucks are going to be coming in for service.
We see the green flag right now. That opens pit road. All the leaders will be coming down. Here comes Shane onto the access road, followed by Ted Musgrave, Jack Sprague, Matt Crafton, and all the other leaders will be on pit road.
All these trucks have to maintain 35 miles an hour on pit road so they don't get penalized. Shane Meal, the first one coming down. Wendy, what's happening?
Well, Ted Musgrave makes his way down pit road. There will be absolutely no adjustments on this one truck. About 10 laps ago, the team got together and had a pep talk. They said, we lost this race last week because of pit stops. It's not going to happen again. They're going to take four tires and fuel. Jackman Rick Pennington comes around to the left side. Let's go to Ray Dunlap.
15 is in, Wendy, the Spawn Divot Chevrolet for Shane Meal. They had just about got on the adjustment. Down four rounds on the track bar, and they're going to go down a little bit on right rear air pressure. He was very loose off. We see Ted Musgrave will beat these guys out of the pits. Then it looks like Sprague will get out next, but Shane Meal's going to lose four spots here in the pit road.
How important pit stops are as far as your crew getting you out on time. Jack Sprague making a great pit stop, even though he had major adjustments, gets out second.
We saw how long it took Shane Meal to get by Jack Sprague earlier in the race when his truck was so much better. Well, now he doesn't only have one truck to get by. Ted Musgrave won the race off pit road, and there are about three or four other trucks in front of Shane Meal, so he's got his work cut out for him.
Ted Musgrave with the strongest truck in Texas last week. Ended up having problems with the right front. We hope that doesn't happen again this time. We'll be back for Green Flag Racing. Memphis. Welcome back to the O'Reilly 200 on Speed Channel. See Shane Meal currently being shown in fifth position. He was your leader as we went to break after the caution. We take a look at his pit.
It wasn't a horrible pit stop, but he had just a few minor problems. Watch the front tire changer up here. When he gets done changing the tire, he's going to put the other one on. He's going to have to reach down and grab another lug nut. See, watch his hands. He had to reach down on the ground. And now watch the jack man. There's a rear tire off Jack Sprague's truck. He has to jump over that, so that slowed him down. So right now he's had two things that have slowed him down, and that's all it takes. Here's another view here. See him come around the front of the truck. The jack man has to jump over that tire off of Jack Sprague's truck. See, now Jack Sprague's truck is going up on the left side about the same time as Shane Meal's, but he's going to be able to change his left side tires quicker than Shane Meal because he was able to beat him out of the pits. Ray, what do you have to add?
Well, Phil, I just want to talk pit strategy with you here a little bit. Now, here's the thing. A number of these guys were hoping to pit at around lap 120 or 130, but now if you're out front, it's almost forcing you to consider not stopping again. But many of the guys that are a little further back in the field right now, like Chad Chaffin and Rick Crawford, are saying, if we get another caution, I think we'll pit at lap 130 just to try to get an advantage. I don't know what you think about that, but maybe being up front right now is not going to be the best place since we've still got 93 laps to go in this race.
Ray, I think I like the guys up front right now. The drivers that are going to be back, Chad Chaffin's right now in the 15th position. He would have so many good trucks to try to pass if he only had 20 laps fresher tires. So I think you're going to have to be way off or way at the back to make a pit stop and make it work to your advantage.
Ted Musgrave out in front of the field as they get the green flag to restart. Jack Sprague, second out of the pits. Currently in second after making major adjustments to the number 16.
A lot of traffic. You have the lap trucks on the inside of the racetrack, the lead lap trucks on the outside. Good shot of Shane Seek, the 07 truck. That's John Woodward looking out of his onboard right now. That's Terry Cook, the Power Stroke Diesel Ford on the inside.
Riding along with John Wood. Looking back at Lance Hooper, that number 13.
Lance is being shown one lap down, along with Terry Cook is actually being shown three laps down right now. But see, those trucks are running side by side, and it has Shane Meal behind them. Not only did he restart from the fifth position after leading, he's now behind two lap trucks running side by side, the worst possible scenario.
At what point in time does Shane Meal get up there and bump one?
Well,
come on, guys. I need to get going.
Very soon, really. He needs to let them know. And the flag man will be working with them, giving those trucks the move-over flag to say, hey, there's a lead lap truck behind you. You guys need to get single file, move over, and let him go. Now you've got the 59 of Mark McFarland, who drove up on the inside of Shane Meal while he's trying to make his way around the lap trucks.
And so Shane Meal out of the ideal groove, which is down on the bottom. Mark McFarland taking that away from him. Carl Edwards in the same predicament, as well as Bobby Hamilton.
In clean racetrack, Shane Meal and Ted Musgrave were very, very similarly speed-wise. But now you've got Shane Meal that's currently being shown in the fourth position, and he's almost 2 seconds behind. So if they run the same speed on clean racetrack, he's got a pretty big hole to dig his way out of right now.
As big as a drop as Shane Meal made, going from first to fifth coming out of the pits. Another driver made a big advance. John Wood went from eighth to fourth coming out of the pits. He's currently being shown in fourth position behind Dennis Setzer.
See, Bobby Hamilton, the Ford truck, moved to the outside of Shane Mill. I don't think Shane Mill's truck is near as good as it was prior to that caution flag. I don't know if they made some adjustments and maybe went the wrong way, but he is not near as good as he was prior to that caution flag.
Phil, we're over halfway through this now. How frustrating is it for Shane Mill having inexperienced trucks in front of him, because he was just bumped, I believe, by Mark McFarland.
Watch that. Here's Mark McFarland right there. Makes a little contact with the inside of the truck, but again, he's not able to get by the lap truck. You've got Lance Hooper, the 13, not Bobby Hamilton. And Carl Edwards are trying to get after him. Now he's finally able to clear the 13 lap truck of Lance Hooper. Now he's got to go after the 59 truck and the truck that's right in front of the 59 truck, the 10 of Terry Cook. But in the meantime, he's now 5 seconds behind.
Again, how frustrating is that for a guy who's been running well on this track and has inexperienced drivers around him?
Incredibly frustrating. And it's not necessarily that they're inexperienced drivers. They're laps down and they're not running as fast as these leaders. So by being behind them, he's slowing down. He went from a 5-second lead prior to the caution flag. Now he's has a 5-second deficit and four trucks in front of him.
Dennis Setzer currently being shown in fourth. Ray, what's happening with Dennis?
Well, Rick, they made a pretty significant air pressure adjustment on his truck. Also went up 2 rounds on the track bar, and that'll loosen him up a little bit. Setzer said the truck is actually so much better than happy hour, he's not exactly sure what in the world it is, but he's pretty happy with it where they're at right now. Now, we see that he has been fighting with John Wood out there a good bit. Now Wood is by him, but Setzer says that the truck feels better now than it did at the start of the race.
On board with John Wood, Dennis Setzer now. Looking ahead at John Wood from Dennis Setzer's Chevy Silverado. Three different leaders, Jack Sprague, Shane Mill, and Ted Musgrave, out in front of the field at Memphis Motorsports Park. Tuner Transformation. Went into Speed Channel on Tuesday at 7 p.m. They get your keys and your car. You get to do anything they want. Every show, one viewer will have their ride transformed into the ultimate tuner car. Tuesday at 7 p.m. on Speed Channel. Caution flag flies for the third time at Memphis Motorsports Park. Debris on the backstretch this time.
Ted Musgrave not able to shake Jack Sprague. That's the thing about caution flags. It looked like Jack Sprague was so much better or so much worse than Ted Musgrave prior to the caution flag, but these teams are always constantly adjusting on these trucks, making them better. We heard Ted Musgrave didn't make any adjustments. Well, I'm sure Jack Sprague did, and it appears that maybe he made his truck a little bit better.
Shane Mill in the Spondivitz 15 was able to move back up just behind Dennis Setzer.
You talk about whether he's frustrated not being able to get by the lap trucks. That's get out of my way. You've held me up long enough. I'm going by is what that is right there.
Shane Mill making the pass, getting just behind the 46. Chevy Silverado of Dennis Setzer. Mill sitting in fifth. Ted Musgrave continues to lead. Truck Series O'Reilly 200 on Speed Channel is brought to you by the United States Army, an army of one, and by Chevy Trucks, the most dependable, longest-lasting trucks on the road. Debris brings out our third caution of the day. That came out on lap 125. They cleaned that up, and only a handful of trucks have come back down pit road now.
Only one of the lead lap trucks, that was Rick Crawford. He gave up his position, and now he's on the tail end of the lead lap, or he's actually at the back of the lead lap trucks. Currently 24 trucks right now on the lead lap.
Ray, what's happening?
Well, Rick, I just wanted to follow up with what Phil said. Rick Crawford was running ninth, and he did give up that position. But basically, he was one of those guys kind of like talking about what I said. He was back far enough. Even though he was only in ninth, he wasn't moving ahead at all. And he said he felt like that set of tires was not as good as the first set he had. So if he was going to have any chance to move further forward, he needed this other set of tires. So they decided just to change four. They didn't really change the chassis, and he just gave him four new Goodyears.
The continuing research and development of Toyota in the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series has been exciting to watch. Let's take a closer look in this week's Toyota Spotlight. Mike Skinner currently running in 11th spot, top Toyota so far.
Teammate Travis Quappel back in 14th, Bill Lester 15th. Hank Parker Jr. 16th. Hank has some experience here on this racetrack in a Busch car. He's made four Busch starts with a best of fourth back a couple years ago.
Wendy touched on at the beginning of the show the short track woes that Toyota's had. Doesn't look like they're improving those right now with no Toyotas in the top 10.
Yeah, the Toyotas have only had two top 10 finishes in the two short track races we ran this year. A fifth by Skinner in Martinsville and an eighth by David Ruderman, also at Martinsville. So right now they need to get their short track program going. We talked about it at the very beginning of the show. Was this the time they were going to overcome it? So far it doesn't look like it's going to happen this week.
We've got a lot of racing to go still. 70 laps still on tap for the O'Reilly 200. Mike Dolan continues to pace the field around the track. He will take that pace truck in this time by. Dennis James has grabbed the green flag and we're about to go back to racing. Ted Musgrave continues to lead. He's led 27 laps. Jack Sprague has led 55 of the laps so far. Shane Meal 48. So Ted Musgrave trying to gain another 5 points if he can continue to lead this race to the end. At 67 and almost sideways, there's Jack Sprague coming out of turn number four.
You talked about Ted Musgrave trying to get 5 more points for leading the most laps. He was able to do that at Texas last week, and remember he told Ray Dunlap that he tied the winner in a set for the same amount of points because he led the most laps. Well, that would have been true prior to this year. They have given a winner of the race an extra 5-point bonus, so Dennis Setzer was actually able to get more points than Ted Musgrave. Ted lost 5 points to Dennis Setzer, even though he finished second at Texas.
Ted Musgrave in a familiar place right now out in front. Wendy Norris, what have you got with that team?
Well, actually, funny story with crew chief Gene Need. We all know what an interesting character he can be at times, and when he's running up front, you usually don't ever find him in his pit stall. We walked around and I found Gene. He was in the empty garage area. Next thing I know, Wayne Auden had called down from the tower and told the NASCAR official that Gene Need needs to return to his pit box. So he has walked back over here and he's not on top of the pit box, but he's here.
Well, at least Wendy's able to find him and catch up to him. Ray couldn't do that.
Once he found him, he couldn't keep up with him. Gene was running around, but we've got a change for position here. Dennis Setzer, look at, got a battle for the lead.
On the inside, Jack Sprague trying to get by the one of Ted Musgrave. He has the preferred line as they go across the stretch.
Hey, Rick, those two trucks that are out front right there, both of those physical chassis have actually won races. We documented that Ted's driving CT number 28. He won twice with that last year. And Jack Sprague is driving truck number 39. This is the one that won at Mansfield. He makes that pass and goes back out front. Two chassis that have visited Victory Lane before at the front of the pack.
Jack Sprague will now add to his laps led as he has gotten back by Ted Musgrave. And so a very strong performance by the number 16 team.
But don't look now, but Shane Meal has got by Dennis Setzer and the 50 truck of John Wood with trouble.
Ken Weaver in the 08 gets into the wall in turn number four. Caution comes out.
Appears to be a single truck incident right now. I see no other trucks that were involved. Let's see if we can take a look and see what happened to Ken Weaver to cause him to get in the outside wall. Here they are entering turn. Oh, he just got sideways getting in turn number three. Got into the wall with the outside right rear corner and that swung him around and hit with the right front corner. Pretty hard contact.
And the rule this year, when the caution comes out, the field freezes. You do not race back to the line, and we're hearing that Jack Sprague may be getting black flag for continuing to speed around the track even after the caution had come out.
Well, that would be big. That would be as hard as he has worked to stay up front and get the lead. If they black flag him now, and if they give him a stop and go penalty, that will eliminate any chance he has of winning this race right now.
Wendy?
Well, when that caution came out, there was a lot of talk on what happened with the 16 truck, whether or not he slowed down. The talk is that he may be black flagged. Gene Need jumped on top of the pit box. He's thinking about taking tires. He's going to watch. If Jack Sprague has to come in for a stop and go, he's afraid he might come in for tires as well. And if the 16 does take tires, you might see the one come in and follow him. The team jumped on the wall, but they're just being patient to see what happens to the 16.
There you see the black flag right there being displayed for Jack Sprague.
Chris Showalter, his crew chief, saying, what is going on?
This is unbelievable. That they're really well. And again, maybe if he comes down pit road, gets four tires, it may force a lot of the other drivers to come down pit road and get four tires. But if they all stay on the racetrack, even with Jack with four fresh tires, that's only 30 less laps on him than anyone else will have. I don't think he'll be able to overcome the poor track position.
Well, Phil, we've seen how difficult it has been to pass even the trucks up front. Think about if he has to start at the back of the lead lap trucks. He's got the lap trucks also in front of him on the inside line. He's got way too many trucks to pass in a short amount of time. Let's look back at the replay of the caution. When it comes out, this is Jack Sprague out in front of the 16.
Pulling away from Ted Musgrave. Obviously, the caution flag is out. Then Ted Musgrave slowed down, and Jack's got about a 25 truck length lead right now. And I guess NASCAR deemed that as not slowing down, and they're gonna display the black flag again for him. He did not come down pit road that time. Ray Dunlap.
Well, guys, they are definitely going to put tires on it now because he is coming in here. Basically, Jack's argument was with the bright sun right now, there's no way you can see these caution lights. And, you know, he just didn't see it quick enough. So that's the thing. But they cannot believe that they are going to be made example of as the leader. So they will pit this time. Watch for Sprague to bring that Chevy Silverado down here. They're going to put these tires on and play the hand they're dealt.
NASCAR holding true to their word. Black flag coming out for the 16, as Ray had said, making an example of Jack Sprague. You do not speed when the caution flag comes out.
This is really incredible. I know it's tough for NASCAR to make that call, too, because, again, in my estimation, they're taking him completely out of contention to win this race. Ted Musgrave did not pit. He stayed on the racetrack along with everybody else up through back through about 20th position. A few of the trucks at the very end of the lead lap did decide to come in, and they pitted the lap before that.
Jack Sprague coming up to his pit stop now. Ray?
Rick, his regular guys will go over the wall here. It's George Stone and Michael Byrd. Randy Dean's the jackman. John Fiegler does the gas. And this is a real routine stop for him. Well, the tire starts to get away, but this should be no problem. Basically, they said, we're not sure if we can even change tires since we're being black flagged. And up on the roof is Dave Fuchs Sr., the spotter, and he said, put tires on it no matter what. They can't do anything more that would hurt us than they already have.
We'll be back with more on Speed. Green flag flies at Memphis Motorsports Park. Ted Musgrave taking the green on the restart. Lap 145. Shane Veal tucking in right behind the one, Ted Musgrave.
Shane Veal now has just one truck in front of him. He worked his way from that hole that his pit crew got him into. Restarted fifth after the caution flag pit stop. Now currently running second with just the leader, Ted Musgrave, in his windshield.
Pit strategy, we talked about how important it was. You see that the fact that Shane Veal went from first to fifth. He's been able to take back those spots, get back up into second, and now a great battle for third with Dennis Setzer and Bobby Hamilton.
Bobby Hamilton knows now is the time. There's only 55 laps to go, so he's got to go now. He works to the inside of Dennis Setzer, going to be able to make the pass, it looks like.
Looks like he almost nudged Dennis Setzer there, letting him know, hey, I'm coming.
Well, he had a little bit of momentum. He was so good, we saw him early in the race through the center of the corner. He was able to get up beside him, make the pass. Now he finishes the pass down into turn number three.
Bobby Hamilton's takes over third, sets his sights on the 15 of Shane Meal, and Ted Musgrave continues to lead. After our leader, Jack Sprague, had to drop to the back of the field because of speeding after the caution came out.
Look at all the traffic he's in the middle of. Three wide, and there's going to be a caution right there.
Tracy Hines gets spun around, as well as other trucks avoiding that. I saw the 21 of Hank Parker Jr. also getting involved. Shane Sieg in the 07. Damage to the front of the 21. Tape, it looks as though it was coming off of that truck. And Jack Sprague was on the inside of all of that trying to make that pass.
He made that three wide. I don't think Tracy Hines or his spotter realized that it was three wide. Tracy took his normal line down in the corner, and there wasn't enough room. Let's see if we can take a look and see exactly what happened. See, Jack's on the inside. He's going to dive underneath the 91 of Stout. Tracy Hines comes down the racetrack, does not know that it's three wide. He thinks he's just side by side with a 91 truck. Ran out of room, made contact with the outside wall hard. A couple other lead lap trucks, a 07 of Shane Sieg and the 21 of Hank Parker Jr. getting above. You see, Tracy Hines just does not know that it's three wide.
Well, and there was no place to go for the 91 of J.C. Stout. J.C. Stout would have been taking the low line, and the 88 of Tracy Hines would have stayed on the outside, and all of a sudden, there's no room to go.
Yeah, the 91 of J.C. Stout didn't do anything wrong. It was just Jack Sprague trying to get back up to the front, and he didn't do anything wrong. He drove up completely beside the 91 truck, and unfortunately, Tracy Hines ran out of room. Ray Dunlap.
Hey, Phil, Sprague restarted 28th there, and the big thing they've been trying to remind him on the radio is to be very careful working his way through, because they'd really like to take this same truck to Milwaukee next week. These guys made a deal with him that if he doesn't tear it up, they'll work all day tomorrow to get this thing turned around. It is now Jack's favorite chassis, and they'd love to take this thing to Milwaukee.
So Jack Sprague being shown in 18th position. He tries to move back up through the field. Catch Ted Musgrave. Welcome back to the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series O'Reilly 200 on Speed Channel. Monday at 7 p.m. tune into Speed Channel for Inside Nextel Cup. Show that examines all the racing action from the driver's seat. Join Michael Waltrip, Ken Schrader, Johnny Benson, and host Alan Bestwick. Inside Nextel Cup every Monday night, only on Speed Channel at 7 p.m. Eastern.
Let's see if we can talk to Bobby Hamilton. We think it's time for him to go. Bobby Hamilton, Phil Parsons up in the speed booth. Can you hear me?
Phil, I got you.
Bobby, is it time to go now? You've got just under 50 laps to go. Have you saved that square D Dodge? You ready to go?
Well, I wasn't saving nothing earlier, but we got it got tight. That was so odd because happy hour yesterday evening, but I guess it's the cool temperatures that we're seeing today. But things driving good now. Danny Rollins and the guys done a good job getting me freed up. Still a little tight right in the middle, but I still can get off the corner good. So see what we got.
Bobby, it looks like the 15 of Shane Meal and the 1 of Ted Musgrave are pretty good up front there. Can you get anything for him?
I think the 15 is what everybody needs to be concerned about. Shane's done a good job today. I've been running with him quite a bit, and he's kept his nose clean. He's took up for himself when he needed to, and everything else, he's done a good job. Looks like the 1's a little loose off, so it could get interesting in about 20 laps, I'd say.
All right, Bobby, just inside of 50 laps to go. You guys are done pitting, right? No more tires.
Told me he didn't care to anybody there for me not to come in or I'd fire.
All right, 10-4. Good job, buddy.
Now, can you fire the team owner? Is that possible?
Well, you can certainly say you would fire him anyway.
One guy who's definitely not going to get fired, Shane Meal. What a great run this guy has had. He's currently being shown in second place. His best finish this season is second. That's his best, or sixth. That's his best career finish. Those both took place at mile and a half tracks. Ray, what have you got on the 15?
Well, one thing, Rick, I just wanted to remind everybody, I told him about this story last week, but remember, today is race number 8 of this season, and so far, the halfway leader of each of those races has not won the race. Our halfway leader today was Shane Meal. Now, these guys on the radio have been telling him, be patient, there's plenty of laps left for you to get around Musgrave there. Your truck is better. You were actually running faster. So we'll be patient with it. And Shane said, I'm going to get him when we come off turn 4 here on the restart. So we'll watch that 15. Wendy, what do you think?
Well, guess what? Gene Need is on top of the pit box, and that's amazing. I saw the NASCAR officials give you a hard time as you were pacing in the empty garage.
Yeah.
Gene Need's always a man of words. What do you guys, you planned not to come in that last time when Jack Spray came in for that penalty because you only had 24 laps on your tires. What is Ted saying about the truck?
I mean, we get a little bit better on long runs, so we're just going to stick it out and see what happens.
All right, Gene Need patiently waiting for the green flag to come back out.
Wendy Norris pulling teeth there, getting Gene Need to talk. Shane Meal, we can't talk enough about this team. Billy Ballou putting together this team this year with Shane Meal driving the Spondivitz number 15 and showing off that he was the right choice for this truck.
We remember we saw Billy Ballou last year. He had a number of different drivers in the 15 truck. Here's Shane, his statistics there. Started fifth today. Best finish was sixth at Atlanta and Charlotte. He'd only led two laps prior to this race coming in here. He had some great success in the Busch Series, came back into the Truck Series this year, first time ever in the Truck Series. But Billy Ballou has been here. He spent so much of his own money last year keeping this truck on the racetrack. And now, again, he's looking for sponsorship. Spondivitz has been on board for a lot of the races. He had Earl Small Harley Davidson on board, but he's trying to keep this thing going. He's got DEI power, all new trucks. Richie Waters doing a great job. It would be great to see him win this race. But he's got Ted Musgrave to contend with.
Ray?
Hey guys, this is the same chassis that he ran at Martinsville and Mansfield. It's number 12. And Phil, you documented they had trouble in those races. At Martinsville, they ran over something and broke the rear end gear. And then at Mansfield, they ran into somebody and broke the radiator. So they've been real pleased with this truck, even though they've had some bad luck. But these guys truly believe that he can get this thing done. We'll keep our eye on him as we get ready to go back to green right here.
Dennis James throws him the green flag, and Ted Musgrave leads another lap as he crosses the start-finish line, trying to pick away at the 60 laps that Jack Sprague had led. Now he's at 48, and he is tied with Shane Meal for most laps led.
Right now, they're both concerned about leading that last lap, along with Bobby Hamilton, the Square D Dodge number 4. We heard Bobby say, "I didn't hold anything back. I just got really tight, but Danny Rollins and the crew made some adjustments." We've got just over 40 laps to go right now. It's anybody's race. Look at Shane Meal right on the back bumper of Ted Musgrave.
And Bobby Hamilton right on the back bumper of Shane Meal. And Bobby Hamilton made the comment earlier, "I've been following this kid around. He's doing a great job." Bobby Hamilton patiently waiting for his opening.
He sure would like to see Shane Meal make one mistake anyway. And Shane Meal's thinking the same thing. Look at Bobby Hamilton. Look to the inside. Shane put the block on him there a little bit.
It almost looked like they were going to try three wide, and we saw that did not work when Jack Sprague got in the inside of J.C. Stout and Tracy Hines. Tracy Hines getting in for long.
See, right now, Shane Meal says, "Hey, I'm going to have to get by Ted Musgrave because I've got Bobby Hamilton breathing down my neck. If I don't get by Ted Musgrave, Bobby Hamilton's going to get by me."
And here goes the pass for the lead. Shane Meal on the inside, and as soon as that happens, the caution comes out, and Shane Meal slows back down. Debris is what we're being told in turn number 4 has brought out our 6th caution of the day.
You saw those drivers shut it off as soon as the caution flag come out. They didn't want to get the same kind of thing happen to them as happened to Jack Sprague.
Lesson learned. Jack Sprague was black flag for speeding after the caution. We take a look, see if we see the debris. That's Terry McDonald in the 72 getting sideways.
She got some contact from the 2 of Andy Houston.
Then one truck went up into the wall.
Terry able to do a great job and remain control of that, or keep control of that truck. Saw Jack's brakes squirt by on the inside. Jack is being shown right now in the 18th position. Again, with just 41 laps to go, his chance of winning this race is gone.
Damage to the 12. You see Robert Huffman just behind the 16 of Jack Sprague. 40 laps remain in Memphis. Can Ted Musgrave hold off a hard-charging Shane Meal and Bobby Hamilton? Coverage of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series O'Reilly 200 on Speed Channel is brought to you by Craftsman, the official tools of NASCAR and the NHRA. By the United States Army, an army of one. And by the all-new Toyota Tundra Double Cab. Not just big, life-size. Ray Dunlap.
Well, Rick, wanted to talk to Richie Waters. Richie, how do you keep him calm here in these final laps? I know he's been pretty animated today.
Yeah, he gets a little upset there when he fell behind there on the pit stop, but he's all calmed down now. You know, he's got a better truck than Ted. Ted's holding him up a little bit in the middle, so give him a few laps here, and I think we'll be all right. Let him get back to racing.
All these old guys that go over the wall, did they all get rested up now?
Yeah, they all took a five-minute break. They'll be okay to go the rest of the way. We kind of got a little behind on the last pit stop. The 16 truck let a tire roll into our jack man and knock him over as he's coming around. So he got back out of his wheelchair and jacked the truck up, and we're good to go.
Hey, good luck. That's Richie Waters, the crew chief for Shane Meehl.
Shane Meehl looking for another opportunity to get by Ted Musgrave. It looked as though it was about to happen right before the caution flag came out.
Shane Meehl does not want to see these caution flags because it's taking green flag racing. Every green flag lap is an opportunity possibly for him to get by Ted Musgrave. And we've had a rash of cautions here in the last 20 laps.
Ted Musgrave's last short track win right here. Memphis Motorsports Park.
One year ago.
Musgrave trying to add to the 13 wins he has already this in his career, but has not been to victory lane this season.
Really, until the last couple of races, really wasn't even close to victory lane, but they've got that program turned around. He and Gene, they're on the same page. They've run well every week that since Gene's been back, and maybe they'll hold this thing win it.
Ted Musgrave will again see the green flag on the restart, and we're back to racing.
Shaney's able to clear the lap truck of Terry Cook just like Ted Musgrave did, so he's right there on him. 36 laps to go.
Ted Musgrave out in front of Shane Meehl. It didn't take very long for Shane Meehl to make that attempt of the pass last restart. We'll see if he's able to do it again now. Hamilton again gets right behind Shane Meehl.
And Shane knows he's going to have to go quick because Bobby Hamilton's coming. Looks like Bobby may have the best truck on the racetrack right now, but he's got two trucks in front of him. It's awfully hard to try to make that pass.
Back of the pack, we mentioned earlier, Jack Sprague, our leader, was black flagged because of speeding after the caution had come out. You see what kind of traffic he has to work his way through. He's currently in 17th position, trying to take away the 16th spot from Andy Houston right now, as Ted Musgrave puts some distance between himself and Shane Meehl.
Bobby kind of peeked to the outside to see if that group was possibly there around Shane Meehl. Wasn't quite able to do it, but this is the biggest lead Ted Musgrave's had in a long time. He's got three or four truck lengths right now on Shane Meehl.
Half the second separates Ted Musgrave and Shane Meehl. Bobby Hamilton just behind Meehl in the Square D Dodge number 4. Then the lapped truck, the Power Stroke Diesel number 10 of Terry Cook, just behind them.
I know Ted Musgrave is not going to count his chickens before they're hatched because he had such a big lead at Texas. Ended up with a loose wheel. Got passed with about 5 laps to go by Dennis Setzer. Still able to finish second, but he sure felt like he had that race in the bag.
You know, Phil, as you mentioned, it looks as though Bobby Hamilton having the strongest truck. Caution again will come out. 7th caution as Brandon Witt in the number 38 gets into the wall coming out of turn 3.
Brandon's able to get back going, did not lose a lap. He's one of the trucks on the lead lap. Again, these caution laps are whittling down the possibility for Bobby Hamilton or Shane Meehl to possibly get by Ted Musgrave.
We'll see how much damage actually has been done to that number 38 as we ride on board with Andy Houston.
Some contact right there. Looked like the 12, possibly Robert Huffman, got into the left rear corner of Brandon Witt.
We're going to take a short break. We'll sort this all out when we come back. Ted Musgrave continues the lead at Memphis Motorsports Park. 62 laps is the most anyone has led. Welcome back. The fans continue to have a great time at Memphis Motorsports Park. The O'Reilly 200 continues. We've completed 171 laps of the scheduled 200. Ted Musgrave out in front. He's led 63 of those laps. That's the most led by any driver so far. One driver that we thought was going to be a contender started in 10th place, Dennis Setzer.
Let's see if we can talk to Dennis and see how his day is going. Dennis Setzer, Phil Parsons, can you hear me?
Clear, Phil.
Dennis, after happy hour in the 27th quickest time last night, if somebody told you you would be running in the top five with about 30 laps to go, would you have believed them?
You never know. This Silverado team, amazing deals out. Danny Gilmore, guys, check the truck. You know, we just put it back like it ought to be, and man, these guys put a great Silverado under us every week.
Looks like those front three trucks are pretty strong. You have anything for Musgrave, Meal, or Bobby Hamilton?
Yeah, they're all pretty frisky up there. We're just going to try to keep them in close sight and see what happens. You know, some guys hadn't won a race up there, and maybe they get the bump and bake it around. We've been lucky a couple times, been real good every time right there. So we'll see how it shakes out for us.
All right, good luck, Dennis.
Guys.
We talked about Dennis Setzer in the open being the short track ace, but so far this year, 2 seconds in the short track races, but he's got 2 wins on super speedways.
Yeah, but again, very good everywhere. There's the points as of now. If the race ended right this moment, he would have a 60-point lead on Carl Edwards. Mike Skinner back in third. Rick Crawford. Look at that tight battle for third, fourth, and fifth. Only 5 points separating third through fifth.
50 points separated are top two, so if the race would end now, which it's not going to, Dennis Setzer would add 10 points on his lead over Carl Edwards. 27 laps to go. Ted Musgrave enjoying the caution laps that he's running out in front. Ray, what's going on?
Well, Rick, I just think it's so cool about how the competition has been this year in the Craftsman Truck Series. When Toyota came here or announced they were coming, we knew that all these other manufacturers were going to have to step up their program, and they've done just that. But it's neat to see Shane Meal and Ted Musgrave up front there. Keep in mind, we have had 7 races this year with 6 different winners. Dennis Setzer, the only repeat winner so far this year. So if Musgrave or Meal win, we'll add to that total.
Who's hot, who's not right now in the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series? Obviously, Dennis Setzer, Carl Edwards, 2 trucks that are very hot.
Rick Crawford's turned his season around. He's average finish of 8th the last 3 races. But look at the bottom, who's not?
Guys that are moving backwards in the points race. Tracy Hines moved back 6 spots. Terry Cook's dropped back. David Rudiman's dropped back. You've got some guys that right now are probably a little unsure of how this season's going to shake out. Jack Spray currently running in 14th. Remember, he was our race leader when the caution came out. It was the 4th caution that came out when Ken Weaver had an accident in turn 3. And the problem was, is Jack Sprague stayed in the gas. NASCAR thought that he was going too fast after the caution was displayed, and so they black flagged him. He dropped all the way back to 25th position.
He's worked his way back up to 14th. I mean, that's passing a lot of trucks and a lot of good trucks, but unfortunately, he's going to run out of time. We're going to get this restart here with 25 laps to go, and for Jack Sprague to get back on the top 10 would be a major accomplishment.
Jack Sprague coming into this race, 6th in the point standings. Jack Sprague, a 3-time series champion. Ted Musgrave led the field to the green for the restart. Shane Meal will now try to pick away at that lead that Ted Musgrave has in front of him.
I think Shane wants to try to do it and do it quick. We're going to look to the inside of Ted Musgrave because Ted was able to drive away from him a little bit. Right now, Shane Meal's got a couple truck links on Bobby Hamilton, so if he's going to do something, he needs to do it now without Bobby Hamilton breathing down his neck.
How aggressively can you get right after you run so many caution laps?
Little contact. That's pretty aggressive right there. He's going to bump Ted Musgrave out of the lead. Let's see what happens when they get down to turn 3.
Side by side as they go into turn 3. Shane Meal on the inside. Bobby Hamilton now wants to get on the inside and also get by Ted Musgrave. Meal trying to make the pass. Ted Musgrave staying out there, but he has to give up the top spot. And now Bobby Hamilton, the preferred line. Musgrave drops back to 3rd.
You talk about aggressive. That was an aggressive move. He got in the back bumper of Ted Musgrave, got him sideways, got him up out of the way, and able to make the pass.
Dennis Setzer also trying to capitalize on that, but Ted Musgrave closed the door before he was able to get up there far enough to get into 3rd.
When we talked to Dennis during that caution park, he said some of those guys are pretty frisky up there. Some of them had never won a race. He's talking about Shane Meal. He's got a great truck. And at that point, Ted Musgrave was not quite as quick as he was. He got in the back of him, got him sideways, moved him out of the way. Now he has to contend with Bobby Hamilton.
Currently in first, Shane Meal. In second, Bobby Hamilton. Those two drivers have never won at this track. We've had six different winners in the six races, and if one of those two win, that makes it seven.
Let's take a look at how this pass happened for the lead right here. This may be the winning pass. He sees Shane getting the back of Ted Musgrave. He really gained on him through the center of the corner, got in the back of him, got him sideways. Now he was side by side. I'm sure Ted Musgrave would have liked to have had another shot at Shane Meal, but Bobby Hamilton was there, got in between them.
This is veteran driving, Phil. This is what these guys have talked about all weekend. Bobby Hamilton stressing on it. If you're a veteran here, you know how to drive this track. You know how to pass. Bobby Hamilton took advantage of Shane Meal making a pass and was able to move up into second. Now we'll see if Bobby Hamilton has anything for Shane Meal.
Shane Meal, you mentioned Shane Meal had never won a truck race. He's never won a race in any of the major divisions of NASCAR. This would be his first win. He ran the Busch Series for a couple years, 2.5 years, not able to get a win. This would be his first major NASCAR victory ever.
Shane Meal out in front of the field with 19 laps to go. Moments ago, Jack Sprague, Mike Skinner side by side getting into each other as they came out of turn four. We'll be back for the finish after this. Eighth caution of the day comes out at Memphis Motorsports Park. Dennis James letting the field know to slow down, and they hopefully learned that lesson. Jack Sprague, as we went to break, was on the inside of Mike Skinner and bumping a little bit, and now we see Rick Crawford on the inside of Mike Skinner making a pass.
Great side by side. Rick's going to get a little bit loose getting down in turn number three. You see him get sideways, made a little bit of contact with Skinner, almost had it saved, and around it went. That was right after Jack Sprague had made some contact with Mike Skinner to get by him.
Riding on board with Mike Skinner now.
Remember, the truck on the inside loses a little bit of air off the spoiler. You see Rick get sideways there, almost able to save it, not quite. And you see Steve Park trying to get by on the inside. There's another view over there. Just lost a little bit of air on the rear spoiler. Around him went, was able to keep it out of the outside wall, so very little damage, but lost a lot of track position. Rick was battling Mike Skinner for the 11th position, and right now he's being shown 24th.
There are still 26 trucks on the lead lap. Shane Meal is your leader. And we're closing in on 13 laps of this race to go. Currently, Shane Meal has led 59 laps. Sprague has led 60 laps. And Ted Musgrave has led 68 laps. So three drivers have really dominated this race.
Well, they sure have. And they were very good in practice yesterday afternoon in happy hour practice, along with Bobby Hamilton, who right now currently is our second place truck. Those were the four best trucks consistently in happy hour. But right now, Shane Meal, he may have led 59 laps. He's concerned with one more lap. That's the last one.
Currently, the man who had led 60 laps is being shown in 10th position. Can you believe that Jack Sprague has moved all the way up to 10th?
I said before, if he got into the top 10, that would be a tremendous effort, and he's done a great job. Unfortunately, he's going to run out of time. He'll probably get a couple more positions, but he's not going to get back into the top five unless we have a major accident in the last 10 laps.
Jack Sprague, at the beginning of the show, mentioned how pleased he was with the Chevy number 16. And was running very well, like I'd mentioned. Led 60 laps. That looked like he was going to be the dominant truck today. And then the black flag coming out. Let's take a look back at what has taken place in the race summary. After 188 of the 200 laps, we've got five lead changes between four or three different drivers. Eight cautions for currently 47 laps.
Only two trucks out of the race
that's
right
amazing.
Now.
That's an amazing number.
There's the lap leaders you were talking about. Musgrave leads right now with 68 laps. If Shane Meal is able to lead the rest of this race, he would lead more laps than Ted Musgrave and get the bonus for leading the most laps. And we're not getting one to go again. I really don't understand. Rick Crawford spun out over in turn three and four, made no contact with anybody, and we've had several laps under the caution flag here. They may be wanting to wait and give them one to go, so it will be a single file restart. When they complete one more lap, that will be lap 190, within the last 10 laps of the race, they do a single file restart with all lap lead trucks up front, so there will be no lap trucks to interfere with the end of this race.
Ray, what have you got?
Hey, Rick, Billy Ballou is the owner of that number 15, and Phil has documented what a great job they've done to put together this program this year. So much money spent, but Billy is not down here in the pit box. I've been trying to find him. Well, the reason is he's sitting back in the trailer talking to some sponsors that they're planning on trying to put a deal together to get this truck more well-funded. And Billy doesn't like to stand down here in the pits because he thinks he brings them bad luck. So he's sitting back in the trailer with the sponsor. That's got to be a pretty good deal to be having a sponsor sit around with you right now watching these guys up front.
And watch such a dominant truck.
He couldn't pick a better time to be talking to sponsors about sponsoring this truck, but they've done a terrific job. You see, the finishes that have not been as good as the other finishes have been because of mechanical trouble. Or Ray talked about earlier, he busted the radiator somewhere at one of the short tracks when he got in the back of somebody, but he's done a terrific job today. As Bobby Hamilton said, that he'd done a great job. He did a real veteran move to move Ted Musgrave out of the way, because Ted Musgrave, quite frankly, was holding him up at that point. So he was able to drive away, brought Bobby Hamilton with him, and now he's got about 10 laps, or it will be 9 laps to go when they get back here, to hold Bobby Hamilton off for his first win ever.
It will be a single file restart. There will be no lap trucks on the inside, since we are inside of 10 laps remaining. Shane Meal trying to hold off Bobby Hamilton, Ted Musgrave, short track ace Dennis Setzer, and John Wood, your top five. When they come to the start finish line, we have 9 laps of racing to go.
Trouble already. Two trucks around. Three trucks around. No caution flag. No caution flag. Bobby Hamilton's on the outside of Shane Meal.
Bobby Hamilton trying to take the lead. They're almost three wide as they come out of turn four. Side by side across the start finish line. Shane Meal still out in front. Bobby Hamilton trying to make the pass on the high side of the track.
He drive it down in that corner. Now Shane Meal needs to move him up the racetrack. Use up that racetrack, Shane.
Shane Meal almost sideways coming out of turn number two. Bobby Hamilton still holding his ground on the high side of the track. We'll see if he can hold that number four square D dodge. And now the caution flag flies, and it's going to be Bobby Hamilton, I believe, in front of Shane Meal. We'll see what NASCAR says.
That's who it looked like was leading to me. NASCAR's going to have to sort it out and figure out who was in front.
Unbelievable. We've talked about the line, the preferred line being on the inside of the track, and Bobby Hamilton on the outside's making the pass.
Here they are right now. Obviously, the yellow's out. We don't know exactly when it was out, and whenever the yellow is displayed and the caution lights come on, that's when they freeze the field. So NASCAR's going to have to figure this out. Shane Meal, obviously, you see him running side by side with Bobby Hamilton. That's what a driver is supposed to do when they think there's a conflict, is they drive and run side by side with the other truck and let NASCAR determine who's leading.
And we believe NASCAR has just made that determination. The Square D Dodge number four will be shown as your leader, our fourth different leader in today's race.
That was pretty big, and a pretty big, bold move on the outside of the racetrack. What a great side-by-side battle for the lead.
And the amazing thing is, he made the pass on the outside, Phil.
Yeah, unbelievable. We've seen Bobby Hamilton look to the outside a few times in this race, and I'm sure when he was passing lap trucks on the outside, he said, hey, if I have to use this groove, is it going to be here for me? And he obviously knew it. He was inside 10 laps to go. What a veteran, wily move by Bobby Hamilton.
I always think back to Days of Thunder, and it's Danny Rollins down there saying, I got a match set of tires. You can do it. You can pass him on the outside.
Yeah, well, whatever, it worked, whatever happened. I'm not sure Danny was telling him I had a match set of tires, but Bobby knew what he had, and he knew those trucks in front of him were good, and he knew when the opportunity came, he needed to go for it.
Take a look back at when the flag came out. Now, we've matched the time code on the tapes. You can see the flag coming out, and it's when the lights are displayed, and this is exactly where they were when that flag came out. Bobby Hamilton just in front, and you can see that not even a truck lead separates first through third.
Three wide to the lead as a caution flag comes out. Bobby Hamilton had about a half a truck length lead, and that gives him the lead. Now they're going to get, they've got one to go. They're going to get a restart with four laps to go to decide it.
And fans, don't worry. The NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series always finishes under green. So we will go for sure green-white checkered, but now we've got four laps to decide who will win today's race, the O'Reilly 200. Bobby Hamilton out in front for the first time today.
Right now, Shane Meal says, I've got to get this lead back. I had this victory in sight. I was going to get my first win, and Bobby Hamilton, that veteran, passed me on the outside.
Bobby Hamilton brings the field down the front stretch, and we're back to racing at Memphis Motorsports Park.
He's already into the back of Bobby Hamilton before they even got to the start-finish line.
Bobby Hamilton knows what Shane Meal will do. He saw him move Ted Musgrave out of the way. He's got to be thinking, I got to get out in front of this guy before he can catch up.
Yeah, I think it's obvious that Shane Meal will do whatever it takes to try to win this race. But it was, he just barely moved Ted Musgrave out of the way. But Bobby Hamilton has opened up about a two-truck lead. Three laps to go.
The square D dodge of Bobby Hamilton. His best finish, seventh in 2003 at this race. Battle for sixth. Matt Crafton on the inside of John Wood. They're side by side as the laps continue to dwindle down. Bobby Hamilton with two laps of racing to go goes across the start finish line.
Got a lap truck in front of Bobby Hamilton, Terry McDonald. He's able to clear here with no problem. Lap and a half to go.
Hamilton stretching out his lead on Shane Meal. Meal trying to close the gap as they come up to the start-finish line. The white flag comes out. One lap of racing to go.
We do have a look at three wide back here. Look at Jack Sprague, the 16 on the inside of David Starr. It's a battle for the seventh position right there.
Into turns three and four, Bobby Hamilton bringing the square D dodge out of turn number four, and he will win the O'Reilly 200. Shane Meal with a strong performance coming home in second. Ted Musgrave holding on for third.
That race was won by years and years from a veteran. Years and years of experience won that race for Bobby Hamilton, but Shane Meal has nothing to hold his head down about. What a terrific run by that youngster in that 15 truck. Ray Dunlap.
Hey, Danny Rollins is here, and Danny, congratulations. Boy, I wasn't sure you were good enough to win, but it just shows what that veteran move is.
The truck probably wasn't good enough to win, but the driver, he made up for it right there. When he got out front, I knew he'd take it home. So, Sprinty Dodge, it run good all day. These guys, awesome pit stop. I don't know what else to say.
All right, congratulations. Another victory for these guys. The burnout begins on the front stretch.
Bobby Hamilton celebrating on the front stretch, not moving the square D Dodge number four. He's going to burn the tires completely off of that Dodge. Bobby Hamilton and Bobby Hamilton Jr. are going to have a great Father's Day as they will celebrate tomorrow. Maybe Bobby Hamilton Jr. will give him one of those Sears phones. We'll come back with more celebration. Speed Channel's coverage of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series post-race show is presented by Craftsman. Ray Dunlap standing by with our winner.
But Atlanta Motor Speedway, it was a side-by-side victory as Bobby Hamilton went at it with Mike Skinner. They slid across the lane, and today it was a veteran move that did it, win number six. Tell me about that day today. You weren't out front much, but you were when it counted.
Well, that seems to be us. We thought we fell off this year, and I don't know. Dodge just sent some engineers down there to live with us, got us back on track. It's good to see. I can't hardly catch my breath now that I got out. It's good to see, you know, Ted running good again. Me and Ted started forming a one-team concept with Dodge, but going up to Square D to meet with them guys on our way to Milwaukee, that's going to be excited. Bobby Jr. is quick and happy hour in Kentucky last night. Signed this, and for you, I hope you get me one tonight.
That'd be quite a Father's Day present, wouldn't it?
Hamilton weekend until he gets the Nextel Cup anyhow. So that was pretty cool. Shane Meal, outstanding job. That kid needs to feel like he won. He drove a perfect race today. I think you're going to see a lot of good things out of him. But Square D Dodge, Joey Arrington Motors, Goodyear The tire was awesome. We struggled with that thing for a while. Once we got it hooked up, it really run good.
Okay, congratulations, Bobby. Let's hear from Shane Meal. I know he's dejected. He's standing by with Wendy.
Shane Meal, his best finish of the season, but you're upset. What happened those last laps?
Just some miscommunication. Somebody on our team yelled caution. We had the best truck. The Spawn Divots Alfredo self-storage Chevrolet was by far the best truck all day. We probably led some of the most of the laps, and should have won the race, should have won last week. We'll get it together. I've never won one of these big car races, but I sure am looking forward to big trophies on my shelf. But I think I'll get one day. We're going to try to fix this truck and take it to Milwaukee. I've been good there, so we'll see what we can do.
All right, Shane Meal disappointed with second, but we'll see what he can do next week in Milwaukee. Let's go to Rick Allen.
Shane Meal has a couple opportunities in Milwaukee. He'll be very busy up there. Dennis Setzer holds on to the points lead. He increased it by 5 points over Carl Edwards. Now Bobby Hamilton closing the gap with this win at Memphis Motorsports Park, coming home the winner of the O'Reilly 200. That's our seventh different winner in seven races at Memphis. We'll be back with more. Speed Channel's coverage of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series post-race show is brought to you by Craftsman, the official tools of NASCAR and the NHRA. The Square D Dodge team celebrating their second win of 2004. Bobby Hamilton's sixth NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series win and the second short track victory for Bobby Hamilton. The unofficial results, Bobby Hamilton on top. Shane Meal with a very impressive performance today. Ted Musgrave coming home in third.
Dennis Setzer, short track ace in fourth. And look at Jack Sprague all the way back to seventh from 25th on that restart after his bike flag.
Unbelievable run for him. Andy Houston coming home in 20th. So the Ultra Motorsports team had a positive with Ted Musgrave and fell off a little bit on the Andy Houston side. Memphis Motorsports Park, the site of race 225 for the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series. Bobby Hamilton able to claim the victory, our seventh different winner. And by the way, he started in the top five. All of the winners at Memphis have won from the top five starting positions. For Wendy Norris, Ray Dunlap, Phil Parsons, I'm Rick Allen saying so long. We'll see you in Milwaukee.